What's up everyone, welcome back to Just Finish Coding. This is part 3 of our Dodgeball series on Scratch 3, so let's get coding.
Just finished coding.
Now, quick interjection here, if you've not checked out part 2 or part 1, make sure you check them out before you come here, because we're picking up from where we left off and you'll be very, very lost. So I'll leave a card right here, make sure you check those videos out and then come right back. Now, if you're staying here, I'm going to assume that you've watched part 1 and 2, and in which case we've made quite a considerable progress. So what we have right now is a beach ball or the dodgeball and the player sprite, and the player is able to double jump and move around, and the ball moves exactly the way we want it to, except for a few things. First of all, the player collision is not defined, and also the ball does not disappear when it reaches the left end of the screen, and we definitely want that to happen. So this video is going to be made so that we fix these two things first, okay? Maybe we won't get too much into the collisions right now. We may just have a simple message initialization, but we're going to be dealing with the left end disappearance in detail. So let's actually get into the code right now. So as we can see here with a quick test run, so the ball moves pretty nicely and it jumps from all, it bounces from all the edges. Now we want to make sure that it does not bounce from the left edge, and that's easier said than it is to code. So how we can actually work around this is by actually painting a new sprite, okay? And we're just going to be making a simple rectangle, okay? I just clicked a line. What we want is a rectangle, and I'm going to set the outline to be transparent, and I'm going to be setting the fill to be something around a nice either purple or a brownish color. So yeah, there we go, nice brown. Yeah, that should work out. So in case you're wondering about the color I'm using, that's color 95, saturation 95, and brightness 37. All right, let's draw the rectangle now. So you get a neat rectangle, as neat as you possibly can, and you should get something like this. So perfect, let's centralize that, and there we are. So now you can see we can actually move this across the stage and put this on the left end of our screen. And now obviously it is a visual appearance. Okay, so this is going to look a bit weird, okay, when the user starts the game, but this is actually going to enable us to make sure that the ball disappears when it actually touches this, which it would have to in case it's moving towards the left end of the screen. So it's a bit of a trade-off right here, but I mean, the thinner and thinner you go, the more the less noticeable it's going to get, and the more good your game's going to look. But for my game, you know, I really think this actually adds a nice appearance, especially with a brown color. So I'm going to leave it with this exact width right here, and I'm going to leave it as it is. I'm going to rename this, disappearance. Okay, disappear. Okay, there we are. So that's pretty much it for the naming part of it. Now, what we want to do within the disappear sprite is to have this saved x coordinate. Okay, and that is go to x negative 1, 250 and y 0. And this should go right here. Now, obviously, we still haven't programmed for the collision between this sprite and the ball. Okay, not the player, it's the disappear sprite. And this is when our ball would actually have to disappear. So head over to your beach ball, and within your forever loop, you just have to add one if statement. So head over to control section in your code and grab an if then. Now, you want to go to sensing and grab a touching, okay, not touching color, but we want a touching, and we want to say if touching disappear. Now in case this is, it's time for our ball to hide. Now all we're going to do is hide, okay, and now we want to again pick a random position right here on the right end of the screen, and we are actually coding that right here. So go to whatever, okay, here we are, and we want to remove all this ball steps, etc, etc. Now, in case we're touching disappear, we go to this, we point in direction, show, and then we go right back off the loop. So let's actually test this out. Now, boom, it goes there and it comes right back. Now, obviously, this is a bit weird, okay? We don't want the ball to come again immediately, but we want to add a kind of random time lag to that. So what we want to do for that is to go to the control section in your code and grab await seconds. And now you head over to operators and grab that pick random block of code. So I'm going to pick random from 1 to 3 seconds. I think that's a pretty good lag for our game. Now, in case we want to change that later on, we definitely could. And what I'm going to do to make that easier is to just initialize two variables in the player sprite, and that is going to be min lag and max lag. So min lag is going to hold the lowest possible lag that it can have. Oops, I think I renamed that max low. Yeah, so as I was saying, a min lag is going to have the minimum possible time lag, and max lag is going to hold the maximum possible time lag. So in our case, that's going to be set min lag to be equals to 1 and set max lag to be equals to 3. So make sure you set those two correctly. So yeah, I'm putting my max lag first, so that's going to be it. So now head over to your beach ball and say instead of wait, pick random 1 to 3 seconds. We want to say pick await random min lag to max lag seconds. There we are. So the reason this helps is we're going to duplicate our beach ball sprite a bit later on. And in case we just have them in variables, all we'd have to do is to change them in one place instead of going to every single sprite and actually duplicating it. What I mean is copy pasting the same block of code, not duplicating it exactly. Alright, so now you may be wondering why I didn't duplicate the beach ball first, and by doing that, we would actually have a much more, user-friendly game, if you want to put it. But the thing is, we want to make sure every bit of our beach ball sprite is coded before we actually duplicate it. So in that way, we have to make the least changes in all the sprites. So that's the reason I'm not duplicating it right away, and I'll leave that for the last tutorial. So I'm just going to click save now to make sure that in case, there's a gigantic park cut, my code isn't lost. And let's actually continue coding now. So the beach ball disappears when we actually touch that, and we can test that out pretty well. And the beach ball stops there, and that's really, really awkward. Okay, so how we fix that is we just head over back to the beach ball sprite, and we put the wait right after the hide instead of at the end of that code. So here we are. So it touches that, hides, waits for some time, and then it comes right back. Boom, perfect. Maybe we'll want to increase the ball speed as the thing progresses. I don't know. We'll see that later on. But right now we have ball speed stored under a variable, so that's good even for that. Now the next thing we want to do is to have a quick message initialization, which I'm going to do in the player sprite. You could do this in the beach ball sprite as well. It just makes a little more sense to me to put all, these kind of initializations inside the player sprite instead of the beach ball sprite, because we don't want to duplicate the same bit of code multiple times unless we want that to execute multiple times. And in this case, we don't. So I hope you understand what I mean. And okay, let's actually initialize the message. So what we want to check is when the green flag is clicked, and you can grab that from the events category, and grab a forever loop. Now we want to check if the player is touching any of the beach balls. Okay, so now this is easier said than done, and this is often where people have errors because they just say if touching beach ball 1, and you have to note here we don't have one beach ball, but I mean right now we do have one, but we're gonna have many. So I mean right now, yes, we could have an if touching just beach ball right here. But pretty soon we need to have a bunch of ors if touching beach ball 1, a beach ball 2, a beach ball 3, etc., etc., etc. Okay, so just remember to change that later on. All right, for now, if we're touching the beach ball, then all we want to do is to initialize a new message. And you can do that by going to your events category and saying broadcast. And we're not going to broadcast message 1. Instead, we're going to broadcast collision. Okay, that's going to be our message name. So hit enter and put that right there. That's it we need to do in our player sprite. Now in our beach ball sprite, that's going to be a little different, obviously. And we're going to have a little bit more code, or maybe we'll do that in the player sprite itself. I'm not sure. We'll see that later on. So right now, all that's important is this collision message, and that's going to freeze the game in a way, and the cat sprite's actually going to explode, and we'll have the explosion animation come on a bit later. So right now, that's it we need to do. Let's test this out once, okay? So yeah, it disappears and you can still see there's no collision, but we'll fix that later on. Now, one thing we'll do further is we'll actually add a timer. So I'm gonna make a new variable called time. I'm gonna say time left, okay? Because we're gonna have a simple timer that's gonna count down to zero. And if the timer hits zero, the player wins, and he basically has to survive until that happens. So initially, I'm gonna do this in my player sprite as well. I'm sorry if I forgot to zoom in actually, so that you guys can see the code better. Okay, here we are. So initially we wanna set the time left to be, let's just say 25 seconds, okay? We'll change this later on if we have to. Now we wanna head right to the bottom, and now we wanna duplicate this when green flag is clicked. Now instead of actually the touching beach ball if condition, what we need to do instead is to add a time lag, okay? So first we wanna add a wait. I'm just gonna say 1 second. Instead of an if statement, what we wanna do is to change the time left by -1. So change time left by -1. Here we are. Now we put that inside this. Now in case the time is equals to zero, and we're gonna check this at the beginning of every single loop, not at the end, at the beginning. It still wouldn't make a difference though if we did it at the end, but I just like to do it at the beginning every single time. So head over to your operators and grab an equals to, and now you go to variables and grab this time left tab, and you say if time left equals to zero, then we're just gonna broadcast another message, in which case the player is gonna win. So we broadcast a you win message. So broadcast you win. All right, here we are. And put that inside the loop. And now in case we're broadcasting you win, it means we've won. And in this case, I'm gonna switch over to a you win end screen. So I'm gonna hide every single sprite. So put that hide block of code right there. And in your beach ball sprite again, head over to events and say when I receive, and not collision, we'll code that later on. When I receive you win, we wanna hide. Okay, that is it. So hide, where are we? Here we are. I'm gonna drop the same block of code inside the disappear sprite as well. And this is gonna hide as well when the you win message is broadcasted. So I'm gonna put that time left at the right end of the screen, and I'm gonna double click that in order to make it look like this. I think this just adds a nice elegance to the game, but you could keep it in the normal way if you want to. The next thing I'm gonna do is to edit our backdrop a little bit. So click that stage key right there and click that, you know, that rectangular box, I know what you call it. Now you head over to the backdrop tab, and now all you wanna do is to grab a nice cyan blue color. You'd have to have your brightness to 100 for that. And you have a nice sky blue or cyan blue or whatever you wish to call that. And now you just put it across the entire screen. Now you can see we have a pretty nice image right there. I'm gonna lower the brightness a little bit. And yeah, this looks a lot better. Okay, that's a lot of code. Now one last thing I'll do before I wind up this tutorial, I don't wanna cram too much into this. The last thing I wanna do is to hide all the variables except for the time left, because this is going to make our UI a lot better. So let's test this out one final time. Obviously no collision, the thing goes right there, and you can see our timer is actually counting down, and that's actually good news for us. Okay, so let's actually wait until it hits zero so that we can see all our sprites go hiding. So 9, 8, 7, I'm not going to cut this part of it, I'm just going to wait until it goes to 0, 3, 2, 1, and boom, it's at zero and everything's hiding. Now, yeah, when this happens, we obviously want to hide that time left variable right there. So what I want to do is to head over to your player tab. And now here I'm going to say show variable time left. And right here, after we broadcast you win, we're going to hide the variable time left. Okay, so simple block of code right there, but really, really, really helpful. We don't want the time to be showing -1, -2, -3, -4, and so on. Just hide that. Perfect. Now that's it we're going to be doing in this tutorial. In the next tutorial, we're going to be dealing a little more with the collision of the ball sprite and the player sprite and the explosion animation. And after that, we'll deal with the duplications and the end screens. So there are a few more tutorials coming in Dodgeball, but stay tuned in just finished coding, because we're going to be completing it in just a few more days. So make sure you help me out right now by hitting the subscribe button and the notification bell, so that you're also notified about the future releases, which will be releasing on a day-to-day basis. Also help me out by giving me a like. It really costs you a fraction of time and it helps me a lot, especially since I'm a new growing channel. So thanks for watching, everyone. I'll see you in the next tutorial. Bye bye.